Hampi lies nestled on the banks of the Tungabhadra between boulder-strewn hills. It was here that the Vijayanagara Empire was founded in 1336 CE. It was the world's second largest city with an estimated population of 500,000. Near the north face is a huge monolithic stone door imitating the wooden original in all details. We started at the palace complex. On the east is a small chamber. This group with plaited hair, conical caps and swords are probably members of a foreign embassy sent to the Vijayanagar court. The king ascended from the west side for the Dasara festivities. The Mahanavami Dibba was all hung with rich cloths. The profusion of square pillar markings on the platform surface hints at this former festive splendor. These buildings have two platforms, one above the other, beautifully sculptured, with their sides well made and worked, to which platforms the sons of the king's favorite came for the feasts. Domingo Pays wrote in the 16th century, the carvings depict Arab horse dealers, exotic animals. On the outside were figures of women with bows and arrows like Amazons. Panels depict women as warriors and also show them meting out justice. Stone aqueducts formed part of an elaborate system of channels for supply of water to the citadel. Lengths of open stone conduits placed end to end are raised on tall cuboidal pillars. Similar aqueducts are all over the city. Nuin states that the successor of Harihara II improved the city of Vijayanagar. His great work was the construction of a huge dam in the Tungabhadra and the formation of an aqueduct 15 miles long from the river into the city. Slabs with circular shallow depressions where soldiers were feasted prior to battle. This large ornate granite base is all that is left of the king's palace. It has friezes of battle, horses, elephants and dancers. A flight of steps and the remnants of an elephant balustrade in green chlorite mark the entrance. The underground chamber may have been a shrine. The king's audience hall was the loftiest building in the citadel, said Abdul Razak. Vestiges of pillar sockets on the platform show it had 100 pillars. The space below was filled with decorated pavilions and platforms. Near this is a 12.5-meter trough cut out of a single block of granite, which was used for watering elephants. The Hazra Rama temple was begun by one of the early Vijayanagara rulers. The high exterior enclosing wall has five rows of friezes showing elephants in procession, horses, infantry, dancing girls, and scenes from the Krishna Leela. It presents many transitional architectural features. There's no gopuram. As you enter is an open mandap with tall and ornate cubical type of Vijayanagar pillars. The heavy porch pillars of the Ardha Mandap have cross corbels of the Vijayanagar Pushpa Podugai type with the joining band. In the center of the Ardha Mandap are four exquisitely carved and polished black stone pillars. The well-chiseled bas-reliefs depict Vishnu, Ganesh, Mahishasurmardhini and Hanuman. The outer walls of the Ardha Mandap are richly carved with many fine bas-reliefs depicting scenes from the Ramayana. The mythical Gande Berunda, the symbol of Karnataka state. The Vijayanagar water engineering is on display here too. Epigraphs mention Devaraya. Another epigraph of 1416 current era records a grant by Queen Amnola Devi. Just outside the Queen's palace are deities arranged according to their weekdays. Surya, the sun god, Chandra, the moon for Monday, Mangala, Mars, Budh is Mercury, Brihaspati, Thursday, Jupiter, Shukra, Venus, Friday, Shani, Saturday, Saturn, Rahu, the ascending moon, Ketu, the descending moon. The Queen's bath is plain on the outside. Inside, it is ornate with decorated corridors and projecting balconies. The ceilings of each bay has remnants of elaborate stucco work and variegated designs. This building is architecturally important as its design incorporates the use of the arch and Islamic influence. The zenana is enclosed by a high wall which is broader at the base and narrower above. The watchtowers are not built into the wall and so perhaps are a later addition. The Lotus Mahal is one of the finest structures in the city of Vijayanagara. It is a two-storied open pavilion with an ornate base and 24 square pillars carrying recessed and foliated arches with an interesting squinch below the corners. There are remnants of medallions in the spandrels of the arches, scrollwork along the outlines and lionhead decorations at the apex. The main cornice of the first story has ornate brackets below. The elephant stables have 11 large stalls with high domed roofs. The ceilings have lotus motifs. Abdul Razak mentions the elephants were restrained by chains from the ceiling. The domes are of different types, round, octagonal, or vaulted, and arranged symmetrically. The guards' quarter, the long open central courtyard, is flanked by corridors with symmetric arches. Another example of the Islamic influence on the civil architecture of Vijayanagar. The treasury is now a gallery of artifacts from the Vijayanagar excavations. Virupaksha temple is the longest continuously functioning temple in India. The eastern Gopura's 9 stories soar 52 meters high to dominate the broad Hampi Bazaar. Its architect was Prolonganti Tippa, an officer of Devaraya II. Krishnadevaraya built the three-storied inner Gopura in 1510. Common in Vijayanagar temple layouts is a series of sub-shrines. The three-headed Nandi at the entrance probably belongs at this sub-shrine. The highly honored Rangamandap has 16 composite pillars with rampant yalis. The ceiling panels are among the few remaining original specimens of Vijayanagar painting. This one shows the procession of sage Vidyaranya, mentor to Harihara I and Bukkaraya. The tall 5-story North Gopura has many decorative pilasters. In 1528, one of the most curious and interesting monuments to be seen in the city was constructed. This is an enormous statue of the god Vishnu in his avatar as Narasimha, the man-lion. It was hewn out of a single boulder of granite. Inscriptions reveal it was one of the last editions of Krishna Devaraya. The deity is seated below a Makar Toran springing from two ornate pilasters. There is a large 7-hooded naga above the head. The arms and the figure of Lakshmi were destroyed. Cicero Fredericki writes, they demolished the statues and even succeeded in breaking the limbs of the huge Narasimha monolith. Next to it is a small Shiva temple with a 3-meter high linga. Its base is permanently underwater, even today. Sasivekalu, or the mustard seed Ganesh, is 2.4 meters high. He is seated in an open mandap supported by rough pillars. In his right hand, he holds an elephant goad. He has a cobra wrapped around his belly. When viewed from behind, we see him in his mother's lap. Another monolith, the Kadlekalu or Gram Ganesh, is carved in the round out of a massive boulder, and this one is about 4.5 meters high. The mandap gives a picturesque view over the Hampi monuments. The end of Hampi Bazaar meets the south bank of the Tungabhadra River. This place is now inhabited by fisher folk. Their basket boats or coracles are mentioned in the diary of Domingo Pace. He writes, people cross to this place by boats which are round like baskets. Inside they are made of cane and outside are covered with leather. They are able to carry 15 or 20 persons. And even horses and oxen can cross in them if necessary. Men row them with a sort of paddle, and the boats are always turning round as they cannot go straight like others. In all the kingdom where there are streams, there are no boats but these. As to their stability, Colonel Briggs has also noted, a detachment of the British Army crossed its heavy guns without even dismounting them over the Tungabhadra in 1812 in these basket boats. Hampi Special is a thrilling finale to break back into the present era. We took the electric car from Talligattu village. It drives through Vitalpura Bazaar, where the Portuguese sold the horses that established them on the subcontinent. Remnants of double-story shops still line what was once the broad avenue of a thriving Hampi Bazaar. Early morning at the Vitala temple is surreal. A 12-meter deep stump lies on the ground, broken. The east gopuram rises over it, piercing the sky. Under it, the flagstones have couples and families worshipping. Ganga and Yamuna are beautifully entwined on granite pillars that soar under the Gopuram. Inscriptions name multiple male and female sponsors for the temple. A pillared colonnade runs along the interior of the enclosing wall. The temple itself stands in a large rectangular enclosure. The Vithala temple is the high watermark of perfection of the Vijayanagar style of architecture. The stone chariot houses an image of Garuda. It has all the intricate and delicate details found in a wooden rath. Even the stone wheels revolve. The brick Viman was removed by the collector of Bellary during restoration to prevent the hold from collapsing under its weight. The main temple dedicated to Vishnu faces east. The steps have an elephant balustrade on this side. The central court is now roofless. The deep Simarecta cornice is visible with a continuous frieze of bas reliefs of deities and other figures. The mandap has 56 pillars, each 3.6 meters high. Each of these is a massive sculptural unit measuring up to 1.5 meters across. A large number of slender columnettes form part of the main pillar. Percussion of these gives out soft bell-like sounds, but these do not conform to any specific scale. Some of the inner pillars have figures of women, dancers, and drummers. One image gives us an idea as to what the original Lakshmi Narasimha monolith may have looked like. A giant 2.7 meter granite dwarpal presents a fine specimen of Vijayanagar sculpture. On the north side is a champa tree more than 100 years old. It is said to have been planted by Mr. Robert Sewell, collector of Bellary, when he was overseeing the restoration of the site in 1890. The mandap stands on a highly ornate 1.5 meter tall Adhisthan. With sculptured friezes of horses, warriors, and dancers. The chimera of a bull and an elephant are skillfully carved on one panel. At intervals, there are ornate miniature Viman projections with figures of the Dasavatars. Decorative scallops and water channels are carved seamlessly into the walls. Inscriptions in three languages state that the 100-pillar northeast mandap was built by Krishna Devaraya in 1516 of the current era. Kalyan Mandap to the southeast surpasses even the Mahamandap. It has composite pillars, beautiful ornate ceiling carvings, and yalis. The Vijayanagar yali is a mythical creature with the keen ears of the rabbit, trunk and tusks of an elephant, the vice-like jaws of a crocodile, strong body of the horse, and powerful limbs of the lion. Thank you. One panel depicting Ravan with his 10 heads and 20 arms is particularly detailed. For a coronation, the king would be weighed against precious gems and metals at the king's balance. A bas-relief at the east side base depicts a king and two queens, possibly Krishnadevaraya and his consorts. Further west, past the old stone bridge on the banks of the Tungabhadra, is the mantap of Purandara Das, who sang in Krishnadevaraya's darbar. Purandara Das systematized the method of teaching Carnatic music, which is followed to the present day. He died on the 2nd of January 1565 at the age of 80. Within a short period after his death, the Vijayanagar Empire collapsed. Kuto writes, "They lit huge fires in the magnificently decorated buildings forming the temple of Vittal Swami near the river and smashed its exquisite stone sculptures. With fire and sword, with crowbars and axes, they carried on day after day their work of destruction." 2 years later, Cesare Frederici noted, "The city of Biznagar is not altogether destroyed, yet the houses stand still, but empty, and there is dwelling in them nothing, as is reported, but tigers and wild beasts."